was born in the shadow of her famous brothers, but it didn't take long for Marie Osmond to find her own voice.
Ladies and gentlemen, Marie Osmond. Marie.
She always had this desire to make it on her own. I think she needed it, I think she wanted it, she craved it, and she got it.
And she got it when she was just 13 years old with a number one country song. Before long, a hit TV show, an icon of 70s pop culture.
She's the real deal. She's got the talent, she's got the brain, she's got the looks, she's got the personality, and she's got the drive.
But the drive for perfection took its toll. At 40, with seven children and a new TV show, the girl who has seemed to have everything showed signs of weakness and nearly lost it.
I knew that something was wrong with me. I knew I needed to just get away.
Marie covers things very well. You would never know there was heartache in her life.
In this hour, resilience and determination. A paper rose who was and still is America's sweetheart, Marie Osmond.
This is Headliners and Legends with Matt Lauer.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to Headliners and Legends. Marie Osmond was everyone's daughter, sister, America's sweetheart, the only girl in the famous singing and dancing Osmond family. A generation of us watched her grow up before our eyes on television. Wholesomeness was almost an Osmond family patent. But the glittering trademark smile was often a thin veneer that covered Marie's continuing struggles. For Marie Osmond, it wasn't easy living inside a manufactured image.
We know her best as the bubbly girl next door who teamed up with her heartthrob brother Donnie to entertain us on Friday nights in the late 70s. But she has never stopped performing. From Nashville to Broadway, she is a genuine star. In the last four decades, she has rarely been out of the spotlight. But her story is not the fairy tale many of us might imagine. On October 13, 1959, Olive Marie Osmond is born in Ogden, Utah. Her parents, George and Olive Osmond, are already the proud parents of seven boys when they welcome their first girl into the world. Devout Mormons, the Osmonds are dedicated to their church and to their growing brood. Olive is a homemaker who showers her children with love and attention. George Osmond, who works as a real estate and insurance salesman, is the family's primary disciplinarian.
My father was a sergeant in the Army, and so he had all that training that he brought into the home. He was a very strict father.
The Osmond children inherit a passion for music from their parents. Before her marriage, Olive played the saxophone in a dance band, and both she and George loved to sing. By the time Marie is born, four of the Osmond brothers are performing as a quartet at local events all over Utah. As the only girl, little Marie is the apple of her brother's eyes.
She was the rose among thorns, and we treated her that way.
She always got her way with all the brothers and everything. The parents always gave little sister whatever she needed. The guys were her servants.
As a toddler, Marie develops an extremely close relationship with brother Donnie, 22 months her senior. While their older brothers are traveling around the state singing, Donnie and Marie become constant companions and little troublemakers.
There's video that we have, but it shows Donnie and Marie even with peanut butter on their hands, and they're just totally destroying everything in the house. And the two of them were always just like into everything.
While George takes the boys on tour, Olive stays at home, managing the family business and taking care of Donnie, Marie, and infant Jimmy.
We would go on safaris, these pretend safaris, and these boat trips. I was the captain of a boat, and we'd go to these far-off lands and just be these pirates or whoever we'd want to be.
In 1962, the Osmond Family Quartet is spotted performing their barbershop harmonies at Disneyland. They are asked to appear on the Andy Williams Show, one of television's most popular variety hours.
Hi there, folks, how do you do? We're mighty glad to be here with you.
The audience loves them, and Williams invites the brothers to become regulars on his weekly program. George accepts, closes his business, and moves his entire family from the rural mountains of Utah to Los Angeles. Marie is 3 years old. Soon, the Osmond Family Quartet is one of Andy Williams' most popular acts. During one show, Andy Williams decides to introduce the family's only girl to the television audience.
This little girl is the youngest Osmond brother. No, she's their sister, Marie. Marie? Will you save me a dance on your 18th birthday?
Okay.
The Andy Williams Show brings the Osmonds national exposure. But with this new public scrutiny comes the pressure to achieve perfection.
The whole concept of perfection was instilled into us as a child. And it was important that it was perfect because those that watched us and observed us would expect that out of us. And when people expect it out of you, you got to keep delivering.
Offstage, little Marie watches her older brothers and absorbs the same lesson. To be on stage is to be perfect. Anything less is unacceptable. After Donnie joins the group in 1964, the close-knit family begins to tour the world together.
Ladies and gentlemen, Marie Osmond. Marie, come on out.
Even young Marie occasionally gets into the act.
I love you. I was kind of the novelty, you know, the only sister. And so, you know, hey, folks, we have one girl in the family, and, you know, she can sing, too.
Come make your home in my heart.
While the family is touring the world, Marie and her mother begin collecting dolls from all the countries they visit. It's the beginning of a lifelong hobby. In a family of nine males, mother and daughter become very close. Marie inherits Olive's maternal nature, taking on the role of second mother to her older brothers.
My mother and Marie really were like the best buddies. So with all the brothers, she was always fixing the dinners and taking care of the laundry and running around like mother, just taking care of the brothers.
Life changes for the Osmond family in 1970 when the Osmond brothers release a rock and roll single.
One bad apple don't spoil a whole bunch, girl.
Oh, give it one more try before you give up on love.
The song is a huge hit, and seemingly overnight, the Osmond brothers become pop superstars.
When One Bad Apple hit, it changed every single life completely, forever.
Life is anything but normal for the Osmonds, but Olive and George try to preserve a shred of normalcy for the 11-year-old Marie by letting her bring a childhood friend on the road with her.
She traveled and her brothers would perform, and we would do girl things. We'd do our nails, we'd play with makeup, we'd get our hair done. We'd go shopping. We loved to shop.
But Marie is not without her own ambition. At the age of 12, she decides it's her turn. She confides to her mother that she wants to sing, but not rock and roll. Marie, who has a mind of her own, wants to sing country music, and she wants to sing solo.
It was very scary. You know, people think, well, you came from this big family, so it was easy. Actually, in a lot of ways, it was more difficult because you had something to prove. That you weren't there because of them, but you were there standing on your own two feet. And I felt that country music gave me that.
Mike Kerb, her brother's producer, takes Marie to Nashville to record with legendary country music producer Sonny James.
She was actually sick to her stomach the day she recorded it. But that was the inner strength that Marie had. Even though she was sick, she made this fantastic performance.
Paper Roses is released in August 1973. Marie is 13 years old. The Osmond brothers are on tour in England when the single begins to climb the charts. When they return to the States, Marie's brothers have a surprise for their baby sister.
They told me, they said, go get an outfit, you're in the show tonight. Paper Roses is number one. And the first place I performed it live was Madison Square Garden.
Marie was just dumbfounded. She was just shocked, could not believe that that could happen to her. Oh, I think she was just elated. You know, the fact she could actually say, my brothers have to deal with me now.
Paper Roses marks the first time in country music history that a female artist debuts with a number one record. Coming up, Marie's drive for onstage perfection pushes her to exhaustion. It is 1973 and the Osmond brothers dominate the music charts. The brothers have 10 gold records and earnings in the millions. And now Marie too has a number one hit. But instead of basking in her success, young Marie is driven to be better.
I felt a sense of responsibility to do a job well done. I think that's one thing that my father, and following in that family tradition, that you want to be grateful for everything and do the best job you can do.
At home, the teen idols are surprisingly unpretentious. The family attends church regularly, and all of the kids are required to help out around the house, no matter how many records they sell.
We'd go out and sing to these massive amounts of people, screaming, all that, and go home and do the laundry. Marie would have the number one record, Paper Roses, and then she would go clean the floor or help Mother cook dinner. It was a very normal lifestyle at home.
On tour with the family, Marie is becoming a professional entertainer. At 14, she already looks and acts like a young adult.
She was by far more glamorous than any girls that I knew that were our age. And she had to be. That was her business.
Marie is busy honing her talents as a solo performer when something happens that will change her life. Brother Donnie returns from a tour to finish an album, and his producer makes an unwelcome discovery.
I wanted him to do the harmony, and his voice had changed, and he couldn't sing the high harmony. So I didn't know what to do, and over in the corner of the studio was Marie, and she was there. She was always there for Donnie.
Donnie and Marie wind up recording the entire album together. Within weeks of its release in 1974, the title song rises to number four on the pop charts.
I'm leaving it all up to you.
Together, the attractive, clean-cut teenagers create a pop sensation. Their music is a throwback to the 50s, a breath of fresh air in the decadent 70s. Soon they're in demand everywhere, including the talk show circuit. It is during an appearance on the Mike Douglas Show that ABC Entertainment President Fred Silverman catches their act.
It just so happened that their manager was a very good friend of mine, and I asked him if they'd be interested in doing a special.
Donnie and Marie's manager approaches George Osmond with the idea of building a television special around his charismatic teenagers. He approves, and the news filters home to Donnie and Marie.
I think I heard about it first. I went up to his room, and I said, did you hear we're doing a show together? And it was like, really?
See, I was so young. I was, what, 16? Marie was 14 at the time. How much control can a 16 and 14-year-old teenager have over their career?
I think it was a lot of mixed feelings from both of us. I know that probably in his mind, he thought, well, there goes my recording career, and I felt the same way.
I like it.
The ratings for the special are so high, ABC gives them a weekly time slot.
Hi, I'm Donnie.
And I'm Marie.
The Donnie and Marie Show hits the airwaves in January 1976. Donnie is 18, Marie just 16. They are the youngest hosts ever of a weekly variety series.
Donnie and Marie were so incredibly popular because they were great entertainers. They'd come on stage, they would sing like birds, they could be funny, and the audience just loved them.
Makeup!
It is a traditional variety show. Donnie and Marie sing.
Moving country.
Moving rock and roll.
Dance. Ice skate. Do comedy skits.
Black and white, black and white, black and white, black and white.
Whatever the show's writers come up with. Since all of the Osmonds pool their money, Donnie and Marie are now the family's primary breadwinners. They make all their hard work look effortless, but it isn't.
I just plain do not know how they were able to memorize their lines, do their choreography, work through all those skits they did, deal with all the pressures of everybody telling them what to do, and be able to smile on camera. I do not know how they did it, and I'm their brother.
Marie is struggling to keep up with her enormous workload and her studies. She doesn't stop rehearsing until she knows she has every detail of her act down perfectly.
There were nights that I would sit up until 2 and 3 in the morning making sure that my lip sync was perfect. You know, we had microphones with antennas on the end, and everybody thought, where did they get those? Well, that's before they were actually invented. And so we had to lip sync everything.
It was so much work, and I remember being with Marie at the studio when she was so exhausted she couldn't even eat. She was so tired. But when she got in front of that camera, you would never know it.
The Donnie and Marie Show makes Marie Osmond a household name and a role model. Girls all over the world want to be just like her. But in Hollywood, being a role model comes at a price. And the price is the pressure to look perfect.
It was that era of Twiggy, and I remember, you know, one of the producers, for good or bad or whatever reason it was done, told me that I needed to drop 15 pounds, that I was an embarrassment to my family, that it was the era of skinny, and I needed to be that. And so there was a lot of pressure put on me.
Marie lives on salads and light soups for months to keep her weight in check. It's not long before she becomes America's teenage sweetheart. She looks like she has it all. But the reality is Marie's work leaves little time for fun.
We wanted to get together. It was usually me coming over and grabbing a bite on the set with them. You know, weekends, they were zonked. She didn't have a lot of time to socialize.
Family rules allow Marie to start double dating at 16. No single dating until she's 18. When it comes to boys, her 7 older brothers are as protective as her parents.
Lots of guys wanted to go out with her, and they wanted to make sure that she was going out with the right kind of guys.
Marie's life in L.A. revolves around her work, her family, and a few close friends. When her parents decide to move the entire family back to Utah in 1977, Marie doesn't want to go.
Honestly, when the family wanted to move it to Utah, I was not one of those that was saying, oh, goody. I loved L.A. I'm a girl that was raised in California, and I really enjoyed it. And I was one of 9 votes, and majority rules.
The Osmonds build a $6 million entertainment center and move the show to Utah at the start of the 3rd season of Donnie and Marie. At 18, Marie Osmond is one of the most successful young performers in America. But her smiles cover the pressure she feels to be perfect. Coming up, Marie finds happiness, only to have it turn to heartbreak.
Headliners and Legends will return in a moment.
It is 1978. The Donnie and Marie Show is in its 3rd season.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
But the ratings are beginning to slip. Donnie and Marie are growing up, and their fans are too.
When the whole image of Donnie and Marie became this cutesy little kind of thing, and I'm now 19 years old, and Marie's, you know, 17, 18 years old, we wanted to be a little bit more hip.
The following year, the Donnie and Marie Show is canceled.
I think, like anything, you know, you're very sad that that era is over. It's also very difficult to come from a show that was so successful and then to have it end. It was like, okay, now what?
I think it was time to move on to the next step, where Donnie went his way and Marie went her way and the brothers did their thing.
Now in her 20s, Marie finally has time to develop a more active social life. In 1980, her brother Jay introduces her to Steve Craig, a former Brigham Young University all-star basketball player.
When she first started dating him, I thought, this is it. This is going to be the man she marries.
Oh, she was just so in love with him. And it was such a fairy tale match, Cinderella and the big man on campus.
They date for 2 years before Steve proposes. An ecstatic Marie accepts, and the two are married in an elaborate wedding in Salt Lake City in June 1982.
Marie and Steve's wedding was phenomenal. I mean, it was really the wedding of the century.
After her marriage, Marie continues to work, but she's eager to start a family. Within months, she is expecting her first child. Marie gives birth to a baby boy, Stephen, the next year.
I became a mother when I was 23, and it was the greatest day of my life.
Marie's happiness is soon tempered by shocking news. After a decade of spectacular success, the Osmonds are stunned to learn they are near bankruptcy. For years, their managers have been making bad financial decisions, depleting a fortune estimated at more than $20 million. Since they've always pooled their money, this means the entire family is nearly broke.
We were advised to take out Chapter 11, and that was a dirty word to my father. He says that we're not going to do that. So we hit the road.
What a glorious feeling.
The Osmond family goes back on tour to pay off its debts. Now adults with families of their own, they decide to keep their future earnings separate. For Marie, there are soon more pressing matters at home. She hears rumors that her husband Steve is being unfaithful. At first, she refuses to believe them.
It took all of us almost as a family to show her evidence of this. When she finally realized what it was, she broke. But this was a terrible, terrible blow to her. Her self-image was gone. She didn't know who to trust.
I always thought, you know, here's Miss Cinderella, Miss Perfect, perfect marriage. I mean, I had the same reaction the world did. Marie Osmond, you're kidding. That can't happen.
In November 1984, Marie quietly separates from her husband of 2 years. She files for divorce several months later, reportedly asking for just $1 in alimony and full custody of their son.
When that marriage ended, it was her first major, major heartbreak. And it was pain to the core, to her very, very core.
Marie's heartbreak is compounded by her deeply held religious beliefs. In the Mormon church, marriage is considered an eternal bond. For Marie, this makes the failure of her marriage even more devastating.
The public didn't see Marie's heartache because she had grown up as a child in front of the cameras that you're always happy and you do the show and you make other people happy. You don't want to burden other people with your problems.
Coming up, Marie turns from heartache back to her first love, country music.
This is Headliners and Legends with Matt Lauer.
By the age of 25, Marie Osmond is already a showbiz veteran of 22 years. She's had a number one record and played to standing room only crowds with her brothers. She also knows what it's like to have a TV show canceled and a marriage fail. But she's getting good at picking up the pieces.
Here's a song that I hope y'all remember.
After her divorce from Steve Craig, 26-year-old Marie Osmond throws herself into her career, focusing on getting back into country music. But even after 23 years in show business, Marie has to convince record executives she can still sell albums.
I had to go and knock those doors and say, give me a shot because I know I can do it. I know I can have hit records. I need the material and I just need the chance.
She was very determined, young lady. She really wanted to be in the country music scene.
After 6 months, Capitol Records decides to give her a shot. To prove her commitment to country music, Marie and 2-year-old son Stephen moved to Nashville in 1985. Once there, Marie immediately heads back into the recording studio.
It was something I think people were ready for and maybe a little surprised at what they heard. It was a different Marie. It wasn't the young voice, the paper roses. It was a woman.
Her duet with Dan Seals, Meet Me in Montana, hits number one on the Billboard country charts. It is her first recording with someone outside of her family. The two win the Country Music Association Award for Duet of the Year in 1985. Marie Osmond is back on top.
Oh my gosh. I think in a lot of ways it was very healing for me to be able to take that piece of my life and to have success with it again.
I think she always had this desire to make it on her own as Marie Osmond. Not of Donnie and Marie, not of the Osmond family, but herself. I think she needed it, I think she wanted it, she craved it, and she got it.
Marie is balancing her new solo success with single motherhood. With three-year-old Stephen in tow, she travels the country performing more than 200 dates a year.
I'm gonna stay here all night. I mean, I had played every fair and festival and honky-tonk, and we'd go in and we'd just rip the place apart. It was great, and people were dancing and stomping and loving it.
Only months after her divorce, Marie meets Utah record producer Brian Blazo at a birthday party for her brother Jimmy.
Brian made Marie laugh, and she had been hurting so much that that was a nice island for her to be on.
It added a whole different dynamic to Marie's life, and such a fun, loving, outgoing, kind of a jovial person.
With a blossoming relationship, Marie is once again burning the candle at both ends. By the summer of 1986, her health begins to suffer.
I had to find a reason to get up out of bed and do a show and then fall back into bed until the doctor could figure out what was going on with me.
What's going on is a debilitating illness, mononucleosis. Marie is forced to put her tour on hold, but after treatment and a few weeks' rest, she's back on the road. Her latest single, You're Still New to Me, a duet with Paul Davis, soars to number one by summer's end. You know,
time won't be stealing that old first time feeling. You'll always be new to me.
By now, Marie realizes she's in love and wants Brian to be her husband. So Marie takes the first step and proposes.
I don't think she got down on her knee or anything, I think. But it was, I think, it just a matter of a conversation, kind of. I think we ought to get married.
In October 1986, Marie and Brian Blazo tie the knot in a low-key affair with family and close friends. The following year, Brian and Marie begin their family together by adopting a baby girl named Jessica. The couple knows Jessica's biological mother, and when she must give up her newborn child, they believe the baby is destined to be part of their family.
Marie has such a tender heart. And when she learned that a child needed a home, it wasn't even a thought.
In 1989, Marie gives birth to her third child, Rachel. A few months later, she is back on the road, bringing her husband and young children with her.
She was always there with her kids before the shows. If you saw her on the road, as grueling as it was, she would be there. She would have her kids there. She maintained a normal family life for those kids.
It isn't long before Marie's oldest son, Stephen, joins her on stage, becoming the latest in a line of famous singing Osmond children. He is just 5 years old.
They were playing honky-tonks all over the country. And little Stephen put on that cowboy hat and went out there and sang, "All my exes live in Texas." It was cute.
But traveling with Stephen isn't always easy. He suffers from childhood asthma.
I almost lost my oldest boy twice. One time was on the road, we were on tour. I had a breathing apparatus with all the medicines, and back then we had to mix them all, whether it was 2 a.m. or 3 a.m. It was very scary. And I mixed it all, he couldn't breathe. I plugged it in and the machine didn't work. And so I told the bus driver to drive as fast as he could. And within 25 minutes, we went right past a children's hospital up in Canada, and they saved his life.
That experience bolsters Marie's commitment to children's hospitals and the charity she had helped found, the Children's Miracle Network. Every year, she co-hosts the CMN Telethon, raising millions of dollars for children's hospitals.
Ladies and gentlemen, Marie Osmond.
If it weren't for kids, have you ever thought there wouldn't be no Santa Claus?
Yeah, she has a tremendous heart for kids. That's one of the cornerstones of the Children's Miracle Network. It does not attract anyone who does not absolutely go head over heels gaga for children. And that starts with her.
As part of Marie's personal crusade, every year she takes time to visit with hospitalized kids who've been helped by the Children's Miracle Network.
This my right arm. It was purple. You should see how purple it was.
Was it kind of scary?
No, it was bad, but I said you saw it all purple.
You know what I think? I think you're an awesome kid. And I'm really glad I know you.
I've been through the hospitals. I see those kids. I can tell you story after story of walking into a neonatal area, which is the premature infants, seeing a little boy who is literally 1 pound, and his dad standing by his little neonatal bed that says donated by CMN, and the father with tears in his eyes said, "Thank you for all you do, or my little boy wouldn't have been here."
Thank God for kids.
In 1988, the Country Music Association presents Marie with the Roy Acuff Community Service Award for her work. Coming up,
she starts singing, and I think, oh dear, the critics are going to rip her apart because she's lip syncing.
Osmond enters the 1990s as busy and successful as she's ever been. With 3 children, a solid marriage, and a thriving country music career, her life is full and happy. For most women, that would be more than enough, but Marie is ready for new challenges. At the age of 31, she turns her childhood hobby of collecting dolls into a business, creating and designing her own collection, then selling it directly to the public.
Marie's an incredibly bright businesswoman. She's hands-on all the way, from picking the wig that doll gets, to the color of the eyes, to the lace on the slip under the dress.
I love it. I love art. I sculpt. It's also very therapeutic for me because I love creating those little faces. It's really fun.
The dolls are just the beginning of a series of new challenges. After her 4th child, Michael, is born in 1991, Marie leaves country music to try her talents in a new venue, musical theater. In 1994, she stars as Maria in a traveling performance of The Sound of Music.
That was so much fun, because I had to really work hard to learn a different way to sing.
High on a hill was a lonely goat herd, lay, oodle-lay, oodle-lay-hoo. Loud was the voice of the lonely goat herd, lay, oodle-lay, oodle-lay.
During this hectic time, Marie and husband Brian decide to adopt 2 more children, Brandon and Brianna.
Marie feels that these children that she has adopted were meant to be her children. No matter how the children came into her family, those are all her babies, and she's the mom.
Now with 6 children, Marie is balancing the role of wife and mother with an increasingly busy career. In 1997, Marie returns to the stage in her biggest role yet, as Anna in the Broadway revival of The King and I. The performance earns her rave reviews, but her brother Donnie doesn't even recognize her voice.
She starts singing, and I think, oh dear, the critics are going to rip her apart because she's lip syncing. And then I started listening a little bit more. I thought, that's somebody else's voice. And I've been in the business long enough, I know when somebody's lip-syncing. And I looked at her, and I thought, she's not lip-syncing. This is my sister's voice.
While performing in The King and I, Marie is approached with the idea of going back into television with Donnie. At first, she's not interested, and neither is he. But then TV executive Barry Thurston poses a question during a conference call.
Well, if you did a show like this, what would it be? So Marie started saying, well, I think it should be this and this and this. And I said, no way, it should be this and this and this. And then Marie and I started going back and forth on the telephone, just having the time of our lives, saying, no, let's do this. No, we're going to do this. And Barry says, stop everything. That's the show.
From the Sony Studios in Los Angeles, California, it's Donnie and Marie.
Donnie and Marie's new syndicated talk show debuts in September 1998.
Donnie and Marie were part of the family's Friday nights for years. They were happy to invite them into their homes. And I think that the new Donnie and Marie show, they were happy to invite them back in. And that's a very important thing.
At first, it's difficult for Donnie and Marie to find their old rhythm. After two decades as solo artists, each has developed a distinctive style.
It took us about a year. And it was almost like a light bulb went on for the both of us at the end of the first season. I turned to Marie just before we walk out onto the set and say, "Now let's just have fun. Let's think back of those times when you were 5 and I was 7. Let's have that rapport again." And it worked.
Well, Donnie and Marie are magic together.
Are you okay?
I'm okay. I'm having fun today.
They're a brother and a sister, so they've got a real-life brother and sister relationship. And sometimes there are conflicts, but most of the time, they get along beautifully.
It's an amazing connection. There are days when they are the only two people that perhaps can calm the other one down. They have a lot of respect for each other, a lot of love for each other, and they also know how to push each other's buttons immediately.
I need to know which one of you two is the biggest windbag.
Oh!
Okay.
Probably
so,
me.
Donnie, all right.
I'm the windbag, he's the airhead.
Okay.
She's kind of the life of the party, which I never would have guessed.
Yeah!
She has this outrageous laugh. And she doesn't mind asking questions that your nosy neighbor would ask. That's a huge part of the appeal.
Marie gives 150%. She never gives just 90%. She always goes so far over the edge. She gives it all. That's all she knows. She grew up that way.
Hosting a daily television show means Marie can settle her family in Los Angeles. But just when she seems most together, Marie Osmond will fall apart.
This is Headliners and Legends with Matt Lauer.
As she approaches her 40th birthday, Marie Osmond has no intention of slowing down. 1998 brings not only the work of hosting a daily talk show, but also a pregnancy, her 7th child. All of Marie's pregnancies have been difficult, but this one is particularly hard.
I mean, I remember being in her dressing room when she was so sick with morning sickness. She'd walk out, touch up her makeup, go on stage, you would never know.
After a prolonged labor, Marie gives birth to a healthy boy on July 6, 1999. But what should be a happy time for Marie quickly turns dark.
The day after she had Matthew, Brian called me and said, "You need to come up here because she's so depressed. She's so upset. You do feel alone. You feel terribly alone. And you don't understand why you're going through something when you should be one of the most happy times of your life."
Just a few weeks after the baby's birth, a shaky but determined Marie pulls herself together and returns to work.
First day back, she said, "I'm having a tough time." At first, I think she said, "I'm not sure what it is. I've never really gone through this before. You know, I've had a lot of infants in my house, but I'm just not myself."
For the first time in her life, Marie is facing an obstacle she can't seem to overcome. By August, Marie feels completely hopeless and overwhelmed. One day, she sits in her closet for hours, sobbing.
At that particular time, I knew that something was wrong with me. And I know I'm an analytical person, but nothing made sense. And that's when I knew I needed to just get away and figure out what was going on.
In desperation, she hands her children's babysitter a credit card and, without a destination, gets in her car and leaves. A few hours later, her husband reaches her by cell phone, persuades her to check into a motel, and goes to get her.
I feel that's the lowest Marie has ever been since I've known her, because I've never seen her like that.
Marie is diagnosed with a severe case of postpartum depression. But with therapy and medication, she manages to go on.
She knew she had a show to do every single day, and she would go out there on stage, and knowing that she could depend on me in case she falters. So that was kind of a nice fallback for her during those difficult months of her life.
And that's what Marie's training was all about, is you don't let people in on your horrors and your problems.
But after a few months of trying to deal with her depression privately, Marie is inspired to do something she's never done before.
When I finally came head to head with it, it's when my mother came forward and told me that she had suffered with it exactly the same way I had, but she had never told anybody. And it bothered me that there was shame with it, because her telling me that really helped me. And that's when I decided to come forward and talk about it.
You know, I did the Oprah show.
I was just gonna say, and I mentioned this to you after I saw your interview on Oprah, when you talked about your depression. I thought it was so admirable for you to say what you said, not just for what you said or how you said it, but that you did come out and talk about it. I admire you so much for doing that.
Well,
I really
you.
Do.
Marie is touched and surprised how many women respond when she speaks out about her own devastating depression.
And after I went forward with it and I received, and I'm not kidding, thousands upon thousands upon thousands of emails and letters from women that said, thank you for giving it a name. Thank you for making me feel like I wasn't alone or crazy. Man, it really got me. I don't have a sister. And in some ways, in a very strange way, it's almost like, wow, I have sisters out there, that you have something you can share and have in common.
In the following months, Marie puts on a brave face and tries to get back to normal. But something else is wrong.
There was a time, a couple weeks there, where I really worried about her, that I didn't know if she'd be able to pull out of this, because she wasn't really disclosing everything that was going on in her life, and I knew something was happening.
What is happening is Marie's marriage is falling apart. In January 2000, she announces that she is separating from her husband of 13 years.
But I do want to say that no outside parties or influences affected this decision, and that I'm doing fine. And that I know that any of you with kids oh, this is a fun show, isn't it? that you'll accept and understand my desire to protect the privacy of my children at this time, and that what I'm doing I feel is the very best for myself and for my children.
Once she got that off her back, I've seen more focus and dedication from my sister. You know, because now all of these things that she was harboring up in her life are disclosed.
Oh, thank you.
During their second season in 1999, The Donnie and Marie Show earns 5 daytime Emmy nominations. But despite increased ratings, the show is canceled in the summer of 2000. It's a blow to the entire staff, but everyone who knows Marie is confident she'll pick herself up as she has before.
Marie has always got opportunities, and she has... As soon as the announcement was made, the phone was ringing off the hook. She's got a great spirit about her, and, you know, she'll be fine.
She's already on her way. In August 2000, 8 months after their separation, Marie and husband Brian decide to give their marriage another chance. Born into show business, working since the age of 3, Marie Osmond has both blossomed and suffered under the pressure of a life lived in the public eye.
I think she's lasted because she's the real deal. You know, she's got the talent, she's got the brain, she's got the looks, she's got the personality, and she's got the drive. And I think that if one door shut, the immediate answer in her mind is, okay, how do I open it?
While charity remains one of the cornerstones of Marie's world, nothing is more important to her than family.
If you look at life and you measure, well, what all the successes, what is the greatest success? I've always said to be a happy grandma, because then it means my life was full, that my children loved me, and that they want their children to be with me. And I want to be surrounded by them. Family is everything to me, and it always has been.
Marie Osmond has grown up and remains a role model for her fans, who've grown up too.
After facing the dark side of show business and personal crisis, Marie Osmond is now taking life one day at a time. She has no plans to turn her back on the sweet image that she says has always worked in her favor. I'm Matt Lauer. Thanks for watching.